Welcome to the basics of inverse Laplace transforms, or essentially pattern matching 101. The best thing about Laplace transforms is that when you invert them, it's like doing Laplace transforms, but backwards. And by that I mean, say we have functions all the time that we use that are inverses. So we have like a square root function, right? And the inverse of a square root function is a square function. It gives you the thingy right back. Or you have a sine function. And we also have something called inverse sine. If I take the inverse sine of sine, I just get x. Well, the same thing happens with Laplace. If I take the Laplace of a function, and then I take the inverse Laplace of that function, I get the same function back. So what's neat about it is by the time you get to inverse Laplace transforms, they assume you know everything you could ever possibly want to know about actual Laplace transforms, so you get to use lots of tables. All right, so let me give you an example. So say I had a problem where I was trying to find the inverse Laplace transform of s times s squared plus 9. Right? Okay. Now, it's as simple as going to the table and finding the thingy that looks like an s over s squared plus stuff. Now, I'm not using this one because this one has a constant or omega out top. The other one has an s on top, and the s on top is what gets me happy. All right, but to make it super obvious what's going on, I'm going to make sure that I can rewrite this in precisely the same format as what I have in the table. There we go. All right, so from this, I can determine that omega is 3. You probably could have figured that out earlier. I'm just being extremely cautious the first time we do this. So that means that the inverse Laplace transform of s over s squared plus 9 is as simple as saying cosine of 3t. No big deal? Good. Now we're just going to do that for like forever, and it's going to be amazing. Okay, now something that's come up is what happens if you have something like this. Let's say that we have the inverse Laplace transform of 8 over s plus 5 plus 7 over s squared plus 3. Okay, now the question might be, can I split these up? Can I take the inverse Laplace of both? The answer is yes, but if you don't believe me, let me go ahead and prove it to you. So let's create a function, some random function, f of t, and we'll say that it transforms to f of s. Then we're also going to have Laplace transform of g of t and say that it transforms to g of s. Okay, so this is not going to be a pretty proof because that's not my style. So if I want the Laplace transform of f of t, plus g of t, I know from linearity that that's the same thing as Laplace of f of t plus the Laplace of g of t. So that's the same thing as f of s plus g of s. Okay? Now, what I can do is I can, let's see, how do I want to do this? I'm going to, that's what I'm going to do. So let me go ahead and rewrite this here on this side. Okay, so I want to take the inverse Laplace of both sides, because I can do that, because it's like taking the square root of both sides of an equation. So I have on the left, the inverse Laplace of the Laplace of something is just f of t plus g of t equals to the inverse Laplace of f of s plus g of s. Okay, and I happen to know that because the Laplace of f is f, that the inverse Laplace of this has to be equal to that guy. And similarly, the inverse Laplace of this guy has to be equal to that guy. So I can sub in. I'm going to sub this guy in here and this guy in here as well. So f of t is the same thing as inverse Laplace of f of s. And g of t is the same thing as inverse Laplace of g of s. And that still has to be equal to the inverse Laplace of f plus g. Okay, so I think that's the proof that we're looking for. Basically, we've shown that if I want to, if I have the, and this, of course, equal signs work both directions, but if I want to find the inverse Laplace of a summation, I can just as easily find the inverse Laplace, I can have the summation of the individual inverse Laplaces. Okay, are you excited? Super excited? Okay, now it's gonna be hard for me. Let's see, I'm gonna try to keep this little table coming along with us wherever we go. So it's gonna be a little awkward and weird, but if you've been watching this channel for any amount of time, awkward and weird is kind of what we do. So kind of our thing, it's amazing. Okay, so here we go. All right, so now we wanna find the inverse Laplace of this guy. So we've decided that I can take the inverse Laplace of each one separately. And then the inverse Laplace of the second one. Now, just like with the regular Laplace transforms, I can pull the constants out. So I have stuff that says s plus 5. So let's see what this means that we could do. Ooh, we're missing something. I wonder which one we're gonna need. Maybe the one that we're missing. Yes, s minus. Hold on. It's a greater than 0, a less than 0, I always forget. It's, a less than s. Because that would make sense, because there. Okay, sorry, talking to myself while doing math, which is pretty standard. Okay, now, there we go. Now it's in no way a mystery of what's going on, but I can pull the 8 out, and I have the inverse Laplace of 1 over, and if you want to be super awesome about it, you can say s minus and then say negative 5, okay? Why would you do that? Just to make it super obvious to yourself for later when you're looking at your notes. Okay, now I have 7 times the Laplace inverse of 1 over s squared plus 3. Now, if I'm gonna make that in the same form as this guy, I'm gonna use this guy because he doesn't have an s on top. Cosine has an s on top, but my example doesn't have an s on top. So to make it beautiful, instead of saying plus 3, I'm going to make it say plus the square root of 3 squared. Now the problem is it's still not exactly what I need it to be because the actual sine function has the omega on top as well. Again, nothing to fear. I'm just going to put a square root of 3 on the top and equate things by dividing the square root of 3 outside of the Laplace transform. Alrighty, so then I've got that's equal to 8 over e to the minus 5t. And then 7 over the square root of 3 times the sine square root of 3t. And we're just gonna do stuff like this over and over and over, which is gonna be fun because this is how you learn how to do stuff. So let me do one more. And one of the things that's gonna come up a whole lot is things like completing the square. So you'll have to use completing the square, you're gonna have to use linearity and things like that. So let's go ahead and we'll do at least one more here, kind of together, because it's neat. So let's do the inverse Laplace of 3s plus 8 over s squared plus 2s plus 5. So as I'm looking at this, when I look at the bottom, my initial reaction is going to be to see if I can factor it. Because if I can factor it, then I can do partial fraction decomposition, and it's going to make my life a lot easier. I could solve it without, but I'm always looking for the most straightforward, simplest, basic way to solve something. However, this does not factor. So another option that I can do is I can do something called completing the square, which means that I can essentially write the same thing, 3s plus 8 over s plus 1 quantity squared plus 4, like that, equals. That's a terrible equal sign, but anyway, that's all right. So I went that there like that, perfect. Because where your placement on the page is like totally critical. Now, if I'm looking over here, if I'm gonna do eventually the inverse Laplace transform of this, hopefully I can kind of look and I can see I'm gonna be doing sines and or cosines, probably both. Also note that this is shifted. So anywhere that I would have an S on the bottom and an S on the top, well right now I have S plus one. So I have an s plus 1 on the bottom, so I'll need to have an s plus 1 on the top. So I'm going to go about seeing if I can make that happen. So I have that this is equal to the inverse Laplace of, all right, so the idea is, okay, I have 3s plus 8. I need it to be 3 times some kind of s plus 1 thingy, so that gives me s plus 3, so I need 5 more, and that will give me the 8. Perfect. So I have 3 s plus 1 plus 5 over this thingy. Awesome. Okay, now I know that, say, x plus y over 5 is the same thing as x over 5 plus y over 5, right? Because I can, you know, do algebra. So I'm going to take the inverse Laplace transforms of each one of these separately. And while I'm doing this, just to make my life a little bit easier, I'm going to go ahead and pull out the constants. So I have s plus 1, s plus 1, 2 plus squared. And I'm going to run into my table, stupid table. And then 5 inverse Laplace 1 over s plus 1 squared plus 2 squared there. All right, and I'm going to make these a little bit smaller so that I can, whoa, that was weird. I'm trying to make this smaller so I can fit it all in one line so it's not so strange looking. And while I'm doing that, you think about what the next step's going to be. You're like, I don't know, I'm just watching this video, so I don't have to learn anything on my own. But that's not how you learn, because you just said you didn't want to learn. Anyway, all right, if I look over here, this first one's rather obvious, and I mean obvious in, like, if you can do Diffie Q and it doesn't give you a hard time, obvious. So essentially what I have here is the S on the top, so that means that's my cosine, except that it's shifted. All right, so since it's shifted, it's e to the minus t. And then what remains is the cosine of 2t, like that. Got it? Good. All right. Now, for the next one, I can't necessarily go ahead and get started because what I need to have on the top is actually a 2, and I don't have one. So I have to put a 2 here and then divide by 2 out front. So that gives me 5 halves times the sine, oh, sorry, it's shifted again, e to the minus t, sine of 2t. Now, this is actually super exciting, whether you've realized it or not. Something really neat has happened. Because if you've been doing Diffie Q, solving characteristic equations, this is essentially a characteristic equation that is the solution to r, which is negative 1 plus or minus 2i, right? Because if we had a characteristic equation like that, we'd have e to the minus t, c1, cosine 2t, c2, sine 2t. So that's actually what we have right here, except we've already got our initial conditions solved for. So this is something to look forward to whenever you actually apply Laplace transforms to, like, actual problems instead of just doing a flat-out Laplace transform. This is why we're doing Laplace transforms. One of the reasons is it allows us to do transformation of problems that actually incorporates the initial conditions so we can get them out of the way right in front and then move on from there. So this should be kind of exciting as we move on.